Thank you, Jared. Tonight we're presenting an award like no other. Not voted by the public, by umpires, or by coaches, but by those closest to the action. Yes, it's the players.
The most prestigious award besides the Brownlow because it is voted by the people that you play against every week.
It means the respect of your peers. Apple.
Just the ultimate player's player.
It's voted by us.
By us.
By us.
It's voted by me.
By me.
By me.
By me.
It's our award.
It's the player's award.
Who will take it home this year?
Who will be this year's MVP?
Thank you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening and welcome to the 2014 AFPA MVP. What a huge year it has been. And once again, we see the cream starting to come to the top. Tonight, though, it is the players who will decide the game's most valuable player. Can Gary Ablett win it for an unprecedented sixth time? Perhaps the smooth-moving magpie Scotty Pendlebury, the brilliant Buddy Franklin, or maybe someone from out west, Matt Prittis and Nat Fyfe, have both had outstanding seasons. Players from all clubs are represented here tonight, and that includes the Fremantle players in Perth at the moment at the Old Brewery in the West Australian capital, and they're preparing to continue their finals campaign. But it is great that they can be a part of tonight, and let's give them all a warm welcome and wish them well for the weekend. The great Lee Matthews was the first ever winner of the MVP back in 1982, the award now named in his honour. 10 years on, in 1992, it was another Hawthorn star. Jason Dunstall had a magnificent season, booting 145 goals. Jason joins us now, and with him is multiple premiership player David King. Would you please make them welcome?
Oh, thanks very much, Sandy. It's an exciting night ahead. I love the players' nice, Kingy, because these are their awards. They own it. This is peer assessment at its best, isn't it?
I want to see who they like and who they don't like, Jase. From their votes, we'll work that out at the end of the night. But you won this award in 1992. You've won a lot of trophies, a lot of awards across your journey. What did this one mean to you?
Well, I think premierships aside, it sits comfortably with any individual honour, because this is about the blokes that you do battle with week in, week out. The blokes that you're fighting hammer and tong with, they pay you the ultimate respect. So it's a fantastic honour. So, Sandy, we've got all of that to look forward to tonight.
Thank you, Jase. Well, it's been an emotional year for a number of players, Luke Ball included. After 223 games, 142 of those with the Saints and 81 with Collingwood, he recently retired. Before we hear from him in his capacity as the president of the Players Association, let us pay tribute to Luke Ball, the footballer and the administrator.
My name's Ian Prendergast. I'm the General Manager of Player Relations at the AFL Players Association. I've had the pleasure of working with Bawley for the last 5 years.
Thanks for coming. On behalf of the entire playing group.
I think Bawley's been the perfect leader for the AFL Players Association due to the fact that he's universally respected by players, but also everybody within the industry. On-field Bawley is an inspirational leader through his acts.
He inspires his teammates around him. He never gives up.
Picked up by Fasolo. Off to Ball. Ball snaps. That's the seal of the Pies at home.
Bawley's legacy will extend beyond what he did on field due to the role he played with the association to introduce initiatives that will benefit generations of players to follow. It would be great if Bawley could continue his great work with the Players Association to develop into one of the future leaders of the game.
Thanks, Sandy, and thanks, Prendit, for those kind words. I wasn't expecting that at all. It's fantastic to see so many of you here tonight helping the players celebrate a great night on our calendar. It is a special night for us. We get to catch up with friends, colleagues and legends from across the competition. And we get to celebrate some great champions of our game in our award winners tonight. Champions that have commanded the respect of their peers with their deeds across the season 2014. And what a great season it has been to date. Full of highlights, the odd low light. Indeed, games of footy, let alone premierships, are getting harder and harder to win. For many of us here tonight, we're at the end of our season. For some of us, we're at the end of our careers as AFL footballers. Speaking personally, whilst it is sad that it has come to an end, I also know how privileged I have been to play this great game and to spend the last 13 years of my life living the dream that so many young athletes aspire to. We must never forget this as players. As tough and demanding as it can be, with all the highs and lows, it is a great and rewarding job that shouldn't be taken for granted. I took over as president of the Players Association in 2012 because I believe in a collective voice and in the players being duly recognised for the role they play in the success of the game. With that comes a responsibility. Our responsibility to the supporters, members and fans of our club. Our responsibility to the communities that support our clubs. And our responsibility to the next generation of players who are to come into our game. The association is part of us carrying out our responsibility. And we should remember also the players in the past that had to fight to get the association recognised. The Players Association represents us collectively, but also individually through its welfare programs, education and training, career transition, legal assistance and financial planning for players. Its purpose, put simply, is to help make its members better players and better people, that we leave the game better than when we started. It is up to each player to buy into this purpose and to proactively and positively seek to influence your profession in your relatively short time in it. It has certainly been a great honour to serve as PA President for the last 2 years. The place is certainly full of committed and hard-working people who I thank for all their work. And I look forward to handing over, I look forward to another young leader stepping into the role next year. But tonight is a night to relax with your friends and colleagues and, as I said, to celebrate our award winners. In particular, a player who will take home the Lee Matthews Award for Most Valuable Player. I wish all the players and the remaining six teams in the finals good luck. May the next 6 weeks be memorable ones for players and supporters alike. Thank you and enjoy the night.
Thank you, Luke, and good luck in the next phase of your career. And so to tonight's award. Voting is a two-stage process and begins when every player on an AFL list nominates three teammates they believe have had a standout year. The votes are tallied to form a nomination list of 54 players across the competition. Players select the most valued player by casting a 3-2-1 vote, but they cannot pick someone from their own team. Votes are then submitted online. So here now are the club by club nominees. And we'll have a look at the 54, starting with the Adelaide Crows. Paddy Dangerfield, another big year. Pierce Hanley was great for the Brisbane Lions. Gibson Murphy, strong for Carlton. To Collingwood, led by Beams and Pendlebury. The Bombers relied heavily on Dyson Heppel and he didn't let them down. Fremantle, Ballantyne, Fife and Sandilands, always very, very strong. The Cats were there again, led by Hawkins and brilliantly led as a skipper by Joel Selwood. Gary Ablett, can he win a sixth after missing a number of games through injury? And Big Mummy, leading the Giants in the ruck division. Hawthorn has a plethora of stars. Bruce, Gunston and Lewis are here. For Melbourne, Nathan Jones is a constant try. He always gives 100%. Ben Cunnington and Levi Greenwood have had outstanding seasons for North Melbourne. For Port Adelaide, they've been magnificently led by Travis Boak. Cochin, Martin and Rance have had wonderful seasons for the Tigers, while Hayes and Riewoldt have again been stars for the Saints. For the Sydney Swans, Buddy, what a year. And the king of the engine room, Josh Kennedy, is there as well. And young Luke Parker, a rising star indeed. For the Eagles, it is Josh Kennedy who has led the way. So they are some of the stars that we are seeing tonight. Without further ado, let us now take a look at our first contender.
Heppel
Liverpool's ability to win the football this year has been outstanding. Am I
wrong? Keppel out of the middle.
He's been very consistent this year.
It's the ability to make opposition players look silly.
Gee, did well there. He's had a really vicious mirror.
He's young, courageous.
Keppel showed courage to play from the deck. Dyson Keppel.
His ability to get himself out of traffic makes him a hard player to stop.
When Job was out, Dyson would have gotten a lot more attention from the opposition side, and he still performed.
And Heppel rolls at home.
He steps up late in games when his team needs him.
Short ball, Heppel.
This year, he's cemented himself as an elite midfielder.
Heppel, not so much of it tonight.
He's been the man that has led the midfield and led Essendon into the finals.
Double hander from Ryder. Heppel on his left boot. Bends it beautifully. The fifth bomber goal of the quarter.
Dyson, a tough year collectively for the Bombers, but a fantastic year for yourself personally. How do you reflect on 2014?
Yeah, mate, it's certainly been a tough year with the Bombers, but, you know, we'll reflect on, I suppose, our first final there. Disappointing end to the year, but I think, you know, we've bred some young boys into the club, got some first-year players, got games into them. So I think overall it's been a really successful year, and as I said, we'll learn from that experience in that final.
Captain goes down in round 12 and you're thrust into a leadership role. You found the challenge really fitting and comfortable with you. It sat well with you, didn't it?
Yeah, I think so. You know, really there was no more pressure put on myself to stand up, I guess. It was really collectively as a group, I think, especially amongst the leaders, really stood up throughout that time. And it's always hard losing Joe, but, you know, I sort of enjoyed that experience, copping a bit more attention from opposition players and whatnot. So I was glad I was sort of able to still go all right.
22 years of age. You're yet to play 100 games of AFL football. Are you surprised you're in this bracket already at such a tender age?
Oh, well, I guess it's been a pretty steady rise over the last 4 years, and, you know, it's very humbling to be, I suppose, mentioned among these type of players, but, you know, I'm still plugging along.
Let's get to the good stuff. Who'd you vote for and why?
I voted for Joel Selwood, just an outstanding player, very hard and a great leader, so I gave him my votes.
Well, good luck, mate. We hope you get enough to take away the Lee Matthews Trophy tonight.
Good on you. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Key. Well, our first award tonight is the Best First Year Player, and to make the presentation, it's the winner of the Best First Year Player from 2013 from the Gold Coast Suns, Jagger O'Meara. Well, Jagger, I guess you're a veteran now with a couple of years under your belt. Tell us the standout differences between your first year and your second year.
Probably a difference between my first year and second year is probably haven't been able to train as much as I would have liked to this year. I've had some problems injury-wise, so probably just getting that continuity has been a bit of a hassle for me this year.
Well, let's hope that clears up quickly, mate. You've got about 10 or 12 years to go, so we don't want injuries dragging you down. Tell us about the Gold Coast Suns. It was a disappointing finish to the season. What did you put it down to?
Yeah, we had a really, really good start to the start of the year, and I think we're sitting at 7-2 and in a really good position. And then, our second half of the year was really disappointing, and we didn't like the way we ended. So we're going to have a really hard pre-season, and hopefully we can make amends for that next year.
All right, six teams remaining. Who's your money on?
I'm going to go with Freo. They were pretty close last year. They didn't get there in the end, but I reckon they'll be pretty good this year.
All right, you better tell us who the best first-year player for 2014 is.
The best first-year player for 2014, presented by La Trobe University, is Marcus Bontempelli, Western Bulldogs.
Bontempelli found a way out. That is an unbelievable effort. Bontempelli.
He's a smooth mover. Uses the ball really well.
Pretore. How about this footy we're watching at the moment? Bontempelli doesn't look quick, but he is. Goes inside the forward 50. Cooney.
His actions speak for themselves.
McIntosh. Slick hands outside of the boot. Gee, the
this kid's going to be good.
Marcus Bontempelli from the Bulldogs.
Bontempelli!
Bontempelli! If it doesn't get you off the couch at home, nothing will! Kiss on my mouth. I need you, darling, come and say
congratulations.
Well, Marcus, you must be thrilled to be recognised by the rest of the playing body in this way. It's a pretty big accolade, isn't it?
Huge honour. I think to have seen some of the players who've won the award before me and to get judged in this way, especially in my first year, is very humbling, yeah.
So you come into the AFL system just before the season started. What were the expectations that you placed on yourself?
I guess when you come into the system, all you want to do is play, really. And I guess the club was really good at being able to downplay the expectation and really just, I guess, allow myself to embrace the year and embrace each week as it came. And as a first pre-season I experienced, it was a big one, and I managed to get through unscathed and eventually debuted round five.
Did you have a favourite moment? Is there one instant that really stood out for you in your first season?
I think it's hard to go past my first win, especially with the club on a big team against Collingwood. So for me, that'll always stand out as probably one of the biggest moments that I'll experience in football. Sure.
What about a first-year player playing against all these opposition players that have been, you know, playing the game for a long time? How do they treat the first-year players? You cop much of a sledging?
I was treated pretty well, actually, this year. I didn't cop any wayward words. So, I probably snuck under the radar a little bit, and hopefully it continues.
I guarantee you it won't, mate. No, not that you're playing this well now. What do you find the most challenging part 1 year into the system?
Gio on his way out mentioned about the day-to-day grind that AFL football is, and I think especially in my first year I found that to be the toughest to deal with, really, is showing up every day in the same mindset to contribute probably physically and mentally as much as you can. So that's something I'll still getting used to and will take a bit to get used to in the next couple of years.
Well, congratulations, mate. You've had an outstanding season and a thoroughly deserved honour. Ladies and gentlemen, the best first-year player for 2014, Marcus Bontempelli. And our second MVP contender tonight is a star midfielder from the Sydney Swans.
Game has gone to another level.
That's a goal from nothing. Kennedy's got two.
Just about the strongest player you match up on in the midfield.
Here's Kennedy again.
Does all the hard stuff, tackles, runs both ways.
Knows how to win the footy in close.
Contested ball winner.
Kennedy, that's a good grab.
He had a big game.
Contested ball king.
He's the best big body midfielder since Cooter.
And quite drag it in. Josh Kennedy comes through. Little toe poke. Gets his own ball. Kept his feet. Straightened up. And one of the best individual goals of the night.
He's pretty hard to play on. He very rarely gets beaten.
Good kick, good man. Now maybe Kennedy. That was clever. He broke the line. And that's a great kick.
Josh Kennedy, a contender for the MVP. Coming up after the break, though, the Robert Rose Most Courageous Player Award.
Good courage.
Going back with the fly.
He's worked so hard. Thomas, courageous that was.
Putting your head in places that it could get hurt.
Hitting the pack hard down there.
Courage is being prepared to take a risk.
Dangerous kick. Oh, Reed, that was wonderful.
It's the ability to go out of your comfort zone and change the game when facing adversity.
Oh, courage.
Oh, he's hurt himself on the line.
But it's also the courage to run and the courage to impact when the game's up for grabs.
Gee, did well there. It's dangerous kick.
That's courage.
Bartell, wonderful courage. He was stunned as he hit the net.
Yes, we'll be presenting the Robert Rose Most Courageous Player Award shortly, and just as we saw, courage comes in many different forms, and it can also mean having the courage to have conversations about your health, particularly regarding getting skin checks. The AFL Players Association has formed a partnership with Cancer Council Victoria. Tiger Jack Riewoldt has displayed courage on and off the field. Would you welcome him to the stage right now? Welcome, Jack.
Thank you.
Jack, before we talk about you as an ambassador for Council Victoria, tell us about your recent scare.
Yeah, well, Sandy, it's not so recent. I've sort of just made it more public recently. But, the end of 2007, got the end of season medical, so I was pretty much around this time of the year, and had a little bit of a tricolour mole on the middle of my back, so I really didn't know it was there. And my girlfriend, Carly, was on me about it, and my mum as well, and being fair-skinned, decided to get it checked out, and got a cut out by Dr. Chris McCormick down in Caulfield, and then 24 hours later I was in at Peter Mac having a big chunk taken out. Turned out it was a pretty cancerous sort of mole, 0.9 of a mil, so when they start getting to a millimetre deep, that's when they start taking your glands out and stuff like that, so it was a little bit scary. But spending so much time in the sun in pre-season and stuff like that, you don't really take that in. But I know that our boys certainly look after themselves now, and it's a bit of a scare, but I suppose spreading the word now is what I'm trying to use.
And no trouble since?
No trouble since. I get regular checks, but my mum's had one cut out as well. So, it's scary, but, I mean, if you can raise a little bit of awareness, and that's why I've sort of jumped on board with the AFLPA and Cancer Council Victoria, to just raise a bit of awareness, not only with skin checks, but any regular health checks, just to make sure that you're chugging along all right and going along at a good pace.
Is that the main thing you're involved in as far as your ambassadorial role is concerned, just spreading the word?
Yeah, just trying to raise some awareness, really. I think one in three people will suffer some form of cancer by the time they're 75, so it's a pretty damning statistic, and the statistics say that you're going to know someone close, or it's going to be a family member that might pass away from cancer as well. So really, in my case, I was very lucky. It was a very sort of quick fix situation where I was able to have the melanoma cut out, but there's people that are in worse situations that I are in that need some help, and it can be avoided as well. So, I mean, I was very lucky that at my stage I was able to be dealt like that, but down the track, that's when you start talking about chemotherapy and all that sort of stuff where it starts to get really scary.
Well, well done in being involved with Cancer Council Victoria. A disappointing weekend, but I think you can look very optimistically towards next season following the second half of this season for the Tigers.
Yeah, look, it was really disappointing on the weekend. We didn't play very well, but I've sat back and watched that first quarter, and the way Port Adelaide played, they were electric. We tried some stuff, and we just couldn't get on top of the game. So, but the back end of the season's been really good for us. Yeah. Nine in a row is tough to do at any level of footy, and we've been able to string some pretty good games together. So. Look, as disappointing as it is, our fans are really, really good for us over the back end of the season, and hopefully they can take some faith out of what the performances we put in, and we can go into another pre-season with a young squad, get some miles under the legs, and come back out fit and firing for 2015.
I'm sure the roar of the yellow and black will be back. Ladies and gentlemen, would you thank Jack Riewoldt?
Thanks,
Jack. Good on you, mate. Time now, though, to have a look at our next contender.
Gary Ablett's almost the ultimate player.
The superstar Gary Ablett!
He's one touch with the ball and always keeps his feet.
Now Ablett's first chance, terrific fend off.
He's strong, he's impossible to tackle.
You try and stop Gary every single week.
He's a superstar!
Put so much time into him, but no one can stop him.
He doesn't look quick, but he never gets caught.
He has such a huge impact on every game that he plays.
Stanley Ablett wrapped him up.
Things that he can do on the field, no one else can. So, the best player I've seen.
He's magnificent.
Ablett gets our vote because we wish he was on our team.
Well, Gaz is the most valuable player in the league.
Gazza, you can't say much wrong about him.
Gaz, kept him guessing as he always does. We don't have to guess the result.
It's a
fantastic highlights there, Gary. I know you wanted to have a look, but you've got to have a quick chat with us, mate, if you can. Just a welfare check. How's the shoulder coming along?
It's going well. I'm about 8 weeks post-op now, and you know, the physio's allowing me to get some movement in it, do some strengthening work, and it's a bit of a slow process, but the surgeon reckons I'll be ready to go you know, week one of pre-season, so I'm kind of looking forward to getting back into it, actually.
I'll bet you are. Now, how does a person like you, who's won everything in the game, every award that's available you've won, set goals for a season, for any given season? How do you set the goals this year?
Yeah, look, I think you go into every pre-season trying to improve. You know, you never stop learning, and you know, you're always looking at areas in your game that you know, you can get better. And I guess, you know, I just went into this pre-season, you know, I think the biggest thing for me was, you know, I think as I get older, I'm probably going to have to move down forward more, and you know, you got these younger guys that are going to step up into the midfield. So just working on my my game down forward, but also just, you know, doing whatever I can for the team to help us hopefully play some finals footy.
Just answer a question for us in terms of what component of your game does Gary Ablett rate the best component of his game? Is it being clean at ground level, contested footy, kicking goals? What is it?
I think just doing the basics well all the time. You know, I think that's the biggest thing. I think if you look at, you know, all the great players, they did the basics well, and that's something that I work on at training in every single session.
Who'd you vote for and why?
Joel Selwood. I'm really hoping he can get up tonight. I think he's been a fantastic player for such a long time. He's a great bloke, a great leader. So, you know, and I think he's had a good enough season to win it.
So. Well, good luck tonight. Hope you take home your sixth Lee Matthews Trophy.
Thanks, Ken. Cheers.
Thanks, Kingy. Our second award tonight is the Robert Rose Most Courageous Player. Now, just to give you an idea of what's required to win this award, North Melbourne champion Glenn Archer has won it 6 times, and Captain Courageous, the Brownlow medalist from the Sydney Swans, Paul Kelly, has won it 5 times. To make the presentation tonight, the 2010 Most Courageous Player, Luke Hodge. Squeeze that finger too tight. I didn't realise you had it bandaged up. Hodgie, what's your definition of courage?
I guess someone who's going to put their head in the hole, put their body on the line, and I guess when that little man in your head says don't go, they disagree and do it. And I guess no doubt the person who wins this award tonight does that consistently.
So does Luke Hodge ever get scared or a touch jumpy out on the field at any stage?
Oh, mate, I think everyone who plays football is at stages throughout a game sort of second-guess yourself and thought you better not go back. But I guess if you're relying on the rest of your teammates to do the same thing, then you better do it yourself.
You've got a couple of exciting weeks ahead. How are the Hawks placed this year compared to last year?
Look, we've got a pretty injury-free list. I guess Cyril's one that consistently gets talked up, but apart from that, we've had a pretty good run the last few weeks. Good to get over the line against Geelong on Friday night after a pretty solid game, but we'll sit back this weekend and have a look who we're playing.
All right, let's find out who the 2014 Robert Rose Most Courageous Player is.
2014 Robert Rose Most Courageous Player is Joel Selwood from Geelong.
Loves Joel Selwood and the way he plays football. He's not scared on the field at all.
What about that? Just ran over the top of a couple.
Uncompromising.
Good tackle, Selwood.
Ruthless.
Amazing what he just did then.
His attack on the ball is something every player should strive for.
Go short. There's Selwood's hurt.
He puts his head over it, gets smashed all the time, but it keeps going.
The truth and soul. Who are you to tell me how to live?
Selwood, long kick. It could skip through. Oh, they talk about the proverbial captain's goal.
Teammates love that kind of thing.
Joel gets a player's vote because he's an honest competitor. Puts his head over the footy, does all the hard things, which we all respect.
Gets the free kick. He is the master.
He's one that we certainly look at from other clubs, and you know, I wish you had him on your side.
Who are you to tell me how to live my life? Because I won't give this up.
Unfortunately, Joel couldn't be with us tonight. He is committed to getting his body right for this week's semi-final clash with North, so accepting on his behalf another star cat, Jimmy Bartel. Thank you, Jimmy, for coming along. But he certainly didn't want to be completely left out of the evening, so Joel was kind enough to find a few moments to just say a few words in respect to this honour.
Hey guys, sorry I can't be there tonight. I hope you're having a fantastic evening. Real honour to be judged by the playing group to be the most courageous, and I'd like to thank the Cancer Council for putting their sponsorship into this award. I think every player that takes the field is courageous. I mean, our sport is brutal, and we get the best out of each other. Wish all the teams participating in the finals all the best, but hope the Cats get it done. Have a great night.
Well chosen words. Congratulations to Joel Selwood. Our fourth MVP contender comes from across the Nullarbor. Another outstanding season from Docker Nat Fife.
Centering kick. Still a chance. Got his own ball. Turned around. Class act.
Nat Fife's role in the midfield and being able to push forward makes him the most important midfielder on the team.
It's the Fife, and Fife lines up and kicks a goal. He's got two.
Midfielder that hits packs and takes marks like a centre-half forward.
He's got the run-up. Oh, and he's marked it.
Oh, he's a good player.
Super classy, has a lot of athleticism and can play anywhere.
Oh, Fife just took up early.
I think the way he plays is very admirable.
Close down by Fife and bang, it's holding a block shot.
He's tough.
Look at Fife, hit the contest hard.
A very good player.
Fife becoming a real power.
He's pushing forward as much as he can, Nat Fife.
Well, congratulations to Nat, and he does join us now from the Old Brewery in Perth. Congratulations, Nat. Good evening. Thanks for joining us. I'm curious what it means to you to be nominated as one of only six MVP contenders by your peers.
Yeah, good evening, guys. Thanks for having me. Yeah, extremely humbling. The other guys that are up for the award as well have all had great seasons, and you look at some of the past winners filled with superstars and some of my idols.
You had a fantastic season in 2013. You won the best and fairest. How would you compare this season to the one that's passed?
Yeah, probably just a little bit more consistent this year, and going into the season I really had a focus to work on my skills and just become a bit more of an all-round player and also a presence going forward. So barring missing a fair few weeks through suspension, I think I've had a reasonably consistent year.
A quick word on the weekend. It was a loss to Sydney, but I think you can probably take plenty out of that. You had some travel disruptions, you had a couple of injury issues, but you were never out of the contest, so you must take great heart from that, given you're up against the competition's best.
Yeah, absolutely. I thought our effort and our intent was there, and I think Sydney showed firsthand while they finished on top of the ladder. They're an impressive team and probably just got us a little bit with their polish and class, and some of their superstar players really came to play. So we'll take some confidence from the game, really reload, and look forward to a big match against Port Adelaide this week.
Absolutely, Nat. Another great season. Congratulations on being one of the six MVP contenders for 2014.
Thank you.
Yes, congratulations to Nat Fife. When we come back, we'll find out who the players voted for as the best captain in the AFL.
The skip of the livers, never looking anything other than a major.
A great captain leads from the front and sets the example.
Pendlebury, who just kept on running, Thomas in trouble. Pendlebury brilliantly stole the ball back.
He demands the respect of his teammates.
He launches the high footy, rewards in front.
Goes into battle every week for his teammates and for his club.
Oh,
needs to be courageous, needs to have the ability to inspire his teammates.
A good captain should be a fierce competitor.
They're ecstatic, so is he.
And have outstanding communication skills.
Joe Watson's saying right now is that this is a game we just have to win.
A great captain stands up in the big moments.
Having a football, Selwood, thanks to Guthrie, comes away.
He has the ability to will his team over the line in tough situations.
What an extraordinary move.
Thank you.
and you, such a fearless soul.
Look at the players that we've said farewell to in 2014. They amassed, listen to this, 4,661 games, 2,392 goals and 17 premierships. Let's put our hands together for the players that have served the game so well in their clubs and have decided to hang up the boots. Coming up shortly is the game's best captain, but it's time now to have a look at yet another contender for this year's MVP award.
One of the best decision makers in the game.
And Pendlebury, know how smooth he is. We know how classy he is.
Either hand or foot, he never wastes a disposal.
Some individual brilliance, a blow like this, Scotty Pendlebury, bit of composure.
That's pretty good, isn't it?
In time and space, he's as dangerous as anyone.
The Pendlebury, oh, part of the seas, beautifully.
Never seems to get caught, seems to have endless amount of time out there.
That's his basketball background.
Decision making, he is so good.
And he's untaggable.
He's always striving to get the best out of himself and therefore inspires others to get the best out of themselves.
And Pendlebury kicks his third. There you are. Three to the captain. And he should get the 3 points.
Unfortunately, Scotty's unable to be with us tonight, but certainly a very worthy MVP contender. Well, our final award prior to the announcement of the 2014 MVP is the best captain, as voted by the players. The winner of best captain in 2012 was Essendon skipper Job Watson, and he's here to make the presentation tonight. Well, Job, there's plenty of different styles of leadership. How would you characterise your own?
Probably pretty demanding. Try and lead by example, I guess, but doesn't always work to plan.
You talk about demanding. I can only imagine how tough season 2014 was, given everything that transpired, the pressure and the uncertainty that weighed upon the players. Must have been even more difficult for someone as captain that had to lead them through that.
Yeah, look, it was, I suppose, for the last 24 months now, it's been very much the same sort of stuff. But I think the whole playing group, you saw Hep early on, the way in which he's developed and a lot of the other leadership group have stepped up. But I suppose many hands make like work.
Mate, the weekend started so well. It was such an impressive first half. It looked like the Bombers were going to march through to the second week. I can, again, only imagine how bitterly disappointed you are with the end result.
Yeah, it was. It was disappointing. It probably something that will burn in the guts for a while to be in that position, and then for North Melbourne to come back and to win the game. Unfortunately, you only get one chance in finals.
Well, hopefully plenty more finals to come in season 2015. I think now's the time for you to tell us who the best captain for season 2014 was.
The winner of the 2014 Best Captain Award presented by L'Oreal Men Expert is Luke Hodge.
Hodge is a great captain, and what makes him so special is his ability to impact the contest.
Hodge got smashed.
He does anything for the team, puts the team first.
Step up when his team needs him and inspire his teammates around him.
He just has a presence. No matter where it is on the ground, you just feel like he's going to have an impact. When we played Melbourne, went back with a flight in the last quarter and the game was over.
Crunches the pack.
He was always going to go.
His single-minded attack on the football.
He's got one of the hardest heads in the comp.
He always leads by example, taking younger players under his wing.
He organises his team and gets them to play for him as well.
Hodge has done it.
Long time no see, Hodgie. Welcome back. You've won plenty of individual honours, but for the first time in your career, the rest of the players have voted you as the best captain. How does that sit with you?
Obviously honoured, as all the blokes are that get awards tonight. I guess when you see the guys are here, Joe Watson, Joel Solder, who I seen firsthand Friday night how good he is, and then you see the other up and coming young ones, Boak on Sunday was just outstanding. So there's so many quality ones. So, but to get the nod in front of them from the blokes who you go to battle against, it is a huge honour.
Well, we just heard from Job talking about his style of leadership. What do you focus on?
I guess I'm quite vocal, demanding. I've never really been one to lead from the front, because I've never really won a beep test or a high jump or agility or speed or anything like that. So I guess passion is something that I have. Hopefully my teammates know that I'll do anything for them on the footy field and off the footy field, and I guess that's why I enjoy being captain, and I guess that's probably one of my main strengths.
What about the toughest part of captaincy? What's the hardest thing you've had to do as captain? Have you had to crack down on any teammates and close mates?
Yeah, of course. That's always. I had a few rippings from Vanders and that when I was a bit younger, so I don't know how those go. But I guess the hardest things are blokes that either miss big games, grand finals, or miss big games through injury. Trying to chat them and keep their, I guess, positivity up. It's even not the 2012 grand final. Sitting in the rooms with a few of the guys there is probably one of the hardest things you go through. But I guess the more you keep your teammates upbeat and keep a positive attitude, you never know what you can do the next year, as we found out.
What about when it comes to selection these days? Does the captain have much influence?
Clarko does ask a few of the older guys his opinion. Normally he goes the opposite to what we say, but he still makes you feel a part of it. But he's very good at coming in and speaking to a lot of leaders or the senior guys to try and get their input.
And what's the balance in terms of how much is captaincy on field and how much of it is off field?
I think the best part about football clubs these days is you've got a leadership group who you try and delegate a lot of the roles to as well. So if you've got six or seven or eight guys that are helping you lead, you're going to be a lot stronger team rather than trying to do it all yourself. And all captains, their biggest mistake when captains first get appointed is they try and do everything by himself. And it's not until you realise two or three years down the track that you're a better side if you do delegate. So that's probably one of the best parts these days.
It's a fantastic honour. Congratulations, Hodgie. The best captain for 2014, Luke Hodge. Thanks very much. Our sixth and final MVP contender is a reasonably familiar character. He's a former Hawk and now making a huge impression in the Harbour City.
This looks dangerous, the sidestep to get his mojo back. Oh, boy.
You know, he runs like a midfielder.
But he's gone.
He's lightning quick.
He ran past 10 of them.
He marks like a power forward. He kicks goals from anywhere.
That's big time.
He can tear a game apart.
He's got his second goal in the space of 2 minutes.
And I think he's taken his all-round game to another level this year.
What about the pickup from Buddy?
Buddy's arguably played some of the best footy of his career in the last 12 weeks.
Franklin from the boundary, he loves these.
He's
marking looks to have improved, as has his defence and his efforts around the ball.
Buddy Franklin getting his knees dirty.
Buddy's always been a great mark, but this year his contested marking has been a real standout.
And Franklin with strength.
And he kicks them from absolutely anywhere.
A 70-metre goal. He really would be worth all the money there.
Yeah, he's a nightmare for opposition teams.
But he's still going. But he's still going. He's unstoppable.
So Buddy Franklin rounds out the top six. And when we return, we'll announce this year's most valuable player. That's right after this break. Welcome back. So let us just recap the top six contenders for this year's MVP award. From Essendon, Dyson Heppel, Josh Kennedy, of course, from Sydney, Gary Ablett, the mighty son, Nat Fyfe from the Dockers, Scott Pendlebury from Collingwood, and Lance Buddy Franklin from Sydney. And to announce the winner of this year's award, please make welcome the inaugural winner of the most valuable player, now named in his honour, ladies and gentlemen, Lee Matthews. Welcome, Lee. You look at some awards, take the Brownlow, for example, and that now is basically dominated by midfielders, but you look down the honour roll of the MVP, and really, you're going from ruckman to midfielder, centre-half back, centre-half forwards. The whole ground is covered.
Yeah, that's true when you look back at the photos around the wall here. There is key position players and the odd ruckman, centre, all midfielders.
How dramatically, if it is indeed dramatic, have the attributes of the modern day player changed compared to when you won it, dare I say, 26 years ago?
Oh, well, fitter, faster, stronger, more skilled.
Yeah, just a few things.
And the next generation, I guess, will be better than the current generation. I mean, they'll just keep improving and getting better. So it's the all those things, just the skills, the athleticism, the ball skills of the modern player is fantastic.
Before you make the announcement, we had a fantastic start to the finals, four huge games. What was the most significant thing, as far as you're concerned, to come out of the first week of the finals?
Well, it was more being at the Adelaide Oval on Sunday.
Have you recovered?
Out on the ground for Channel 7, 3/4 an hour before the game. And it's the first time I've seen a really big crowd reaction to the warm-up that's about 3/4 an hour before the game. I mean, most of the time you look around the MCG and it's half full 40 minutes before the game. But the atmosphere there on Sunday afternoon was just outstanding. Obviously, the home side played well and they were magnificent. But just the atmosphere, long before the opening siren, was what was really memorable for me.
It's something extraordinary. It's quite unique, isn't it? It's like a wall of sound.
Yeah, it is. It is over there. It's the ultimate home ground advantage at the moment because of the atmosphere it's created at Adelaide Oval.
We shall see how they go over there in the West. But Lee, the time has come to announce the winner of the most valuable player for 2014. The microphone is yours.
Thank you, Sandy. The winner of the AFLPA most valuable player for 2014 is Nathan Fyfe from Fremantle.
Got X Factor.
Very complete footballer. There he is again.
Oh. Impossible to match up on.
Fyfe steps a couple brilliantly.
He's tough, he's hard, he takes screamers.
Big mark by Fyfe.
Win the hard ball inside and goes forward and kicks goals.
Fyfe grabs it out of nowhere and snaps a wonderful goal.
Nat Fyfe's marking is as good as anyone's in the game.
Fyfe.
Midfielder that hits packs and takes marks like a centre-half forward.
Oh. Nice grab, Fyfe. He's a cracker.
He is consistently influential.
Fyfe becoming a real power hit.
Oh, it's hard to compare him against anyone, really.
Rolling ball. Langford with a huge job. Right in his wheelhouse, Fyfe. Opens it up. That's why he might hold the most votes in the Brownlow.
Forging his own legacy, I guess, with the way he goes about it.
Reading the ball so well in the air. Strong hands. And he does it all looking like a surfer backpacking around Europe.
Oh, fantastic 2014 season from Fremantle's Nat Fyfe, and very fitting that the Lee Matthews MVP trophy will be presented by his skipper, Fremantle champion Matthew Pavlich, who is making the presentation as we speak. And Pav, just while you're there, mate, before we do have a chat to Nat, I'd love just to get your opinion on the season he's had. Tell us a little bit about someone that sees him week in and week out, and also on the training track.
Yeah, look, I think he's alluded to it a little bit himself before about his consistency. He's been ultra consistent and really applied himself off the training track, some study away from the game, really sort of bought into what Ross and the leadership group have applied and become a leader in his own right, a real team driver, ultra consistent, as I said, and such a competitive beast, which has always been his strength. So I'm wrapped for Nathan, and it's a great feather in his cap, and he should be extremely proud because that honour roll before has some fantastic names on it.
Yeah, well spoken. Appreciate you making the presentation. Good luck for the rest of the season, Matty Pavlich. So, Nat, I guess the question now, as we take it a step further, how does it feel to get the endorsement from the players as the competition's most valuable player?
Extremely humbling and a little bit embarrassing, to be honest, when I look at some of the other names up there. I saw firsthand on the weekend how good Josh Kennedy and Lance Franklin are, and obviously Gary Ablett, I think everyone still acknowledges is the best player in the game. So really grateful for the award.
I think you sit very comfortably amongst those names. But, of course, you can't vote for Fremantle players when you do the voting. So just before we do carry on, who did Nat Fyfe vote for in the MVP?
Yeah, so as I mentioned, I voted for Josh Kennedy from Sydney. Gary got the two, and I voted Rory Sloane for one, because I reckon he'd be a ripper bloke as well, so that's what I voted for.
So where do the players' awards sit in the overall schemes of things, compared to best and fairest and Brownlow medals and the like?
Yeah, I think you alluded to it earlier. It's almost the greatest honour you can get, being voted by your peers. I got a best and fairest last year, and that was a great achievement. But yeah, this certainly is an ultimate award, and as you said, along with a premiership, I think it's the highest achievement you can receive.
Well, there certainly will be no Brownlow medal for you this year. A couple of indiscretions. Would you like to explain yourself? What happened there?
I think the ruling got me on the first one and just clumsiness on the second one. So, certainly something that I'll have to look to cancel out of my game a little bit. And the way I attack the footy, I often do get blokes high. So I'll do a bit of study over the off-season, and because I can't be sitting on the sidelines.
No, you're most definitely needed out on the ground. Did the coach, Ross Lyon, have a word to you at all?
After the second one, yeah, he sort of just said basically what I've said, that he doesn't want me to change my attack on the footy, but the way I go about it, it just needs to be tinkered slightly so I don't give away free kicks and ultimately don't miss weeks through suspension.
All right, well, last year you had the perfect finals preparation going all the way through to the grand final. It's been a little bit different this year. You're going to have to do it the tough way after losing that first final. It's going to be a great test for the playing group, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. We saw firsthand how good Port Adelaide are, and unfortunately we played them in round 23, so not that long ago, but I didn't play that game. But they got strength across all their lines, Boak and Gray in the midfield, and Schultz and Wingard up forward. So a real test for our group, but one we're looking forward to embracing, and hopefully we can get a capacity crowd behind us at Subiaco.
Well, Matt, Nat, we look forward to the last couple of weeks. Good luck for the rest of the season, but first and foremost, congratulations on being named the most valuable player for 2014.
Thanks, Jason, and thanks to everyone who voted for me.
Yes, congratulations once again to Nat Fyfe. So let's see how the top six finished up as far as the voting was concerned. And you'll see that Nat Fyfe was a pretty dominant winner with 945 votes. Gary Ablett in second at 787. Lance Franklin with 428. Dyson Heppel, 274. Josh Kennedy, 234. And Scott Pendlebury, 225. As we recap all winners on the night, and congratulations to all those winners. Besides Nat Fyfe, Joel Selwood, the most courageous player. Luke Hodge, the best captain, and Marcus Bontempelli, the best first-year player. And so now we focus our attention on the second week of the finals. You'll see all the action on Fox Footy, of course. And coming up, the All-Australian Awards, the Brownlow Medal, the Grand Final Parade and the Grand Final Breakfast, to name but a few. To those teams still in the finals race, we say good luck. And for now, we say good night to you all.